Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let me welcome you all to this media brief. This is a customary media brief that is held at the end of the tenure of a chief, the Indian Air Force, a few days before his retirement. So there is nothing very special about this media brief, but I welcome you all to this media brief. I think we have had an excellent understanding relationship between the media and the Indian Air Force in the past, especially so during my tenure. I think we understood each other's professional requirement. We understood the constraints and the environment in which the media professionals and the Indian Air Force operate. We had respect for each other's profession, and we took due care of the concerns of each other. So to my mind, I think we really enjoyed a very good relationship. There were a lot of requests right from the beginning for giving interviews for various media personnel, magazines, newspapers, TV channels. But I have been maintaining that I would give interview only towards the end of my career or my tenure. And I stuck to that. Recently, I've given one or two interviews, three actually. I had plans to honor everybody's request. Unfortunately, two events overtook my activities. Demise of my mother in October end, and my daughter's wedding in November. So all the schedule had been disturbed, and I could get back to normalcy only in the month of December. So I could not find to accommodate everybody's request. I'm sure you'll forgive me for that. But I always encouraged people from the media to call on me and interact for a short duration on any issue. I think I was very forthright. I was very open and transparent in whatever we discussed. And often, I think that information, that interaction helped many of the correspondents and media personnel to enhance their opinion and information and use it for the right purpose. So that way, I think I had very good interaction with many, many known professionals from the media. Once again, I would like to thank you for the cooperation that you have had in the past, and I'm sure you'll continue with this relationship in the future under the new chief. I know you all are looking forward to knowing what has been done in the last 3 years during my tenure as the Chief of the Air Staff or as the Chairman, Chiefs of Staff Committee, the senior most uniform person in the service for the last 29 months. I'll cover that briefly, and if you have any further queries, that I'll answer later on. But I'd like to thank the nation, the people, the government, and especially the Indian Air Force for placing me at the pinnacle of this organization, a very important appointment, which has been tenanted by many legendary visionary leaders in the Indian Air Force, starting with Subrata Mukherjee, the first Indian Air Chief. Then we had P.C. Lal. And of course, most importantly, we have the living legend, Marshal of the Air Force, Arjun Singh. So I thought that I was occupying a chair which had been occupied by a number of legendary figures. So I found that the foundation that has been laid by our predecessors, such visionary leaders, are very solid. All my predecessors had worked relentlessly towards the transformation of the Indian Air Force to make it a multi-spectrum strategic force with tremendous capability in all air campaigns that you can think of. And it would be a big challenge for me as a chief to sustain that transformational growth to provide the deterrence that the country was looking for from its Air Force. As far as achievements are concerned, I will briefly cover that, but before that, I think I must cover the setbacks that the Indian Air Force or the armed forces had during my tenure of last 3 years. I think the first setback, as far as the Air Force is concerned, was the Pathankot terrorist attack. You all know what happened, how it happened. Much has been discussed, deliberated, and a lot of suggestions and recommendations have come about, and those are being implemented by the Ministry of Defense, the government, and of course the Indian Air Force. I shall cover it in detail later on, maybe during the question and answer session. But we have learned our lessons, and I think today I can summarize to say that we are very well prepared to tackle terrorist attacks through organizational training, better equipment, better infrastructure, and better preparedness. The second setback of the Indian Air Force was in terms of the missing AN-32 aircraft over the Bay of Bengal during the monsoon season, which had 29 personnel on board. Unfortunately, despite our effort, substantial effort, both air effort as well as surface and subsurface at the sea effort, we could not trace the aircraft. So therefore, these 29 personnel of the Indian Armed Forces remain untraced and missing. We are looking after their families, all the assistance that can be given in terms of financial or otherwise are being done. So that was a tremendous setback, one of the worst memories in my service career. As the armed forces, I think we have had some setbacks in terms of the Arup agitation, which resulted, to my mind, in an unprecedented situation, wherein I think the esteem of the armed forces had been affected. And I, as the senior most person in the armed forces in uniform, I could not really stem that agitation and resolve those issues adequately. But whatever has been awarded by the government, to my mind, in terms of Arup award, is reasonably good. And I've always told my people that they should accept it. It's been given after 40 years of struggle, and it is substantially good in its award, and we should accept it. And whatever anomalies still persist are being resolved through the one judge commission, Justice Reddy's commission, and the recommendations have already gone to the government, and I'm sure the government will implement those recommendations at the earliest. And the other issue is, of course, I'll not say it's a setback, but there have been some anomalies in the Seventh Pay Commission, which are getting resolved with the involvement of the people in the ministry, the Honorable Raksha Mantri himself, and other stakeholders. We have relentlessly projected the anomalies and the discrepancies or discriminations which cropped up in the transition from Sixth Pay Commission regime to the Seventh Pay Commission regime. Those issues, some have been resolved already through the resolution of the cabinet. Some are still being discussed and deliberated upon. I'm sure those will also get resolved soon. I would have been happy if these issues got resolved before I retired on 31st of December, but it may take slightly longer. Coming to the achievements, I would say that our main focus was on capability building and operational preparedness. In terms of operational preparedness, we had a situation where our combat fleet, the fighter aircraft fleet, were dwindling in numbers because of obsolescence. So we paid a lot of attention towards new acquisitions and upgrade of the legacy aircraft. I would not say legacy, but aircraft which had already served the Indian Air Force for 20 years plus, a midlife upgrade. There's a Mirage 2000, MiG-29, Jaguars, some transport aircraft, etc. We have, with the assistance of the Ministry of Defense, where the cooperation has been full, and the perseverance of the Honorable Raksha Mantri, a number of acquisition cases have been signed in the last 2.5 years or so, including the Rafale, 36 Rafale aircraft, which is coming off the shelf. It will be here in India, operational within next 3 years to 5.5 years. LCA, the indigenous production, fighter aircraft Tejas, we have inducted already. We got 3 aircraft now flying in frontline squadron. And we are going to accept 123 such aircraft over the next 10 years or so. So it will give a lot of boost to the indigenous product for strategic independence of the nation and the Indian Air Force, but also help us in overcoming the teething problems in the quickest manner. And capability-wise is going to see a lot of improvements in the form of Tejas Mark 1. I'm sure many of you already know what are the improvements we are seeking and which will be delivered by the HAL and the ADA combination, with ownership being there of the Air Force as well. So that was about induction. We have inducted C-130s. The second squadron of C-130 will be inducted soon at Air Force Station Arjun Singh, Old Panagarh. By March, April next year, it will give us tremendous capability. We have operationalized a large number of Mi-17 V-5 medium lift helicopters. Contracts have been signed for Apache attack helicopters and heavy lift Chinook helicopters, and some more are in the process to be signed as far as helicopter acquisition is concerned. We're going to get more AWACS, the AWC, large number of missiles, service to air missiles have been inducted, most of them indigenous. Large number of radars have been inducted, are in the process of induction, which are mostly indigenous. And the network-centric warfare capability that we have generated within our own resources, that is indigenous way, we call it the IACCS, Integrated Air Command Control System, which has got terrestrial network, it's got the aerial network, and of course the space-based network. So I think the Air Force is well on its way to have network-centric warfare capability. As of now, it exists and it is going to improve soon. So overall, to my mind, we have done reasonably well in terms of capability building to look after the entire spectrum of threat, subconventional threat, that is the terrorist attacks and attacks of some such nature, or also conventional threat, a conventional conflict, and the other end of the spectrum being non-conventional threat, that is, I think the nuclear threat. So entire spectrum we are looking after, and I think we have done reasonably well. As far as training, operational training is concerned, we found that our serviceability of especially the combat fleets are not very good. A lot of effort has been made, a lot of contracts, revenue cases for spares, aggregates, etc., which are languishing for very long, have been signed because of cooperation and intervention of the Ministry of Defense, as well as Honorable RM's proactiveness. Large number of contracts have been signed, and it has improved the availability of spares and aggregates. So serviceability has improved by 5 to 7% in most of the fleet. We have also done a lot of flying. Average flying that you have done last 2 years was 40,000 hours more than the average of last 10 years. That, I think, is a very substantial jump. That was possible despite number plating or, I would say, retiring many old aircraft like the MiG-21 squadrons and MiG-27 squadrons. We have flown even more in the fighter fleet compared to the previous 10 years because of better serviceability, better rate of exploitation. This 40,000 hours that we have flown has increased the operational categorization of our air crew, combat crew, substantially. We now have a scheme to judge the professional abilities of each and every officer, every crew. This system is going to enhance our professional capabilities of each and every individual as a professional. We have done the same thing in terms of our other air warriors, that is the airmen, wherein we are grading their skills very seriously. We used to have about 20 to 30 ustas, you know, that they are the real, you know, good professionals who lead in their field. Now we have more than 200 ustas. We have large number of people trying to upgrade their skill categorization to skill A and ustad. So there has been a lot of improvement in professional capability of each and every individual in the Air Force. We have flown a lot by night. Previously, the average flying that the Air Force did was about 17 to 20% by night. Now it has been enhanced to 27 to 30% sustained. We improved our electronic warfare capability substantially. We improved our weapon storage, weapons availability substantially, and we are getting good results. We have done a lot of exercises in the recent past, some of which you had been witness to, like exercise Liveware, which was an Air Force level exercise involving all the operational commands, spread over almost a month. And it was one of the largest ever exercise that the Indian Air Force has conducted operationally, taking into certain contingency which we normally never exercise ourselves adequately. But that trend has been stopped, and we are doing substantially well in terms of operational exercises. And of course, we did Iron Fist in 2016 to showcase the Air Force's capability using all its platforms, all the weapons, all the armaments that we have in the store. Each and every platform was used in the presence of the Supreme Commander of the Indian Armed Forces, the Prime Minister, the Raksha Mantri, and many other dignitaries, as well as foreign dignitaries. We flew for almost 3.5 hours this exercise to display our capabilities over day, dusk, and night hours. So that was showcasing of the Indian Air Force's capability for operations to be a good deterrent to adversaries from taking any adversarial positions. In terms of relevance, I think we have worked a lot. We thought that we may fight or may not fight a conventional conflict or war. But definitely, we have to be there to serve the nation, its people. You'll find that for HADR, Indian Air Force has been in the lead. It's been the first respondent in every contingency, be it Nepal, be it Fiji, be it Maldives, anywhere. Retrieving people of Indian diaspora from Sudan, from Yemen, the Indian Air Force was involved in a large way. Aid to the civil authorities, be it the Jat agitation in Haryana, be it general elections in the country, be it demonetization, airlifting currency notes from one place to another, especially from the mints, or even helping the government in running this mints 24/7, the Indian Air Force has played a very important role. So that way, I think our relevance has increased in serving the people. We have also increased our relevance in terms of aid or assistance to other government agencies like the BSF, ARC, railways, and the paramilitary forces. We've been involved deeply in operations against the Naxals in the central parts and eastern parts of the country. We fly day and night, substantial amount of flying for logistic support to our paramilitary forces. And because of such logistic support provided by the Air Force, I think we have perform well in controlling the Naxal operations in those regions. That is about the relevance of the Indian Air Force in the recent times. And another area which have done well is military diplomacy. We all know the drive that our Honorable Prime Minister has taken to diplomatically to take India to a higher status, higher pedestal in the world scenario. And one important aspect of diplomacy or total diplomacy is military diplomacy. We are able to convince the government that there is a need to step up bilateral military cooperation, and we have done so especially in our neighborhood, be it the SAARC countries or ASEAN countries, the Far East, Japan, and many other nations, especially all the important nations. We have done a lot of exercises with them, a lot of exchange visits, and Indian government is ready to sell equipment of Indian indigenous productions to our neighboring states. This, I thought, would help in stemming the situation wherein the voids are being filled by our adversaries. So there has been an important role played by the armed forces, especially the Indian Air Force, in providing the strong pillar of military diplomacy in the total diplomacy for the country. We have built a lot of infrastructure. You can see it for yourself what has happened in the Northeast. The advanced landing grounds have been upgraded and made fit for operations by fixed-wing aircraft. This, we have recently operated a C-17 from Machuca at an altitude of 6,200 feet. The length of the runway is just 4,000 feet. And we landed with 25 tons of logistics within a distance of 2,000 feet. That is the kind of capability we have developed in the Northeast. And we have improved the connectivity in this region where road, rail connections, as well as air connections have been very meager. And the Indian Air Force's effort in developing infrastructure in this region is definitely going to enhance the economic development of that region and integration of the Northeast with the rest of India. In terms of quality of life and standard of living, I think we had made a lot of templates wherein each and every base, every station, small or big, has got a lot of infrastructure towards improvement of quality of life and standard of living. So I feel quite nice that my people are quite happy with the standard of living that they enjoy and the quality of life they enjoy in the Air Force bases and Air Force stations. Most importantly, as of now, I think our concern is tackling terrorist attacks or subconventional threats, towards which we have got the full support of the government in improving the infrastructure that is required to deter a terrorist, to detect any intrusion, and then neutralize them at the earliest before they become a threat to our high-value assets or our people. Toward this, we have done a lot in terms of training of our people, right from the basic ab initio stage, orientation of our air warriors, to be able to tackle a well-trained, well-motivated, well-armed terrorist. We are now training a large number of people for such duties. We're improving our weapons that we have. And of course, our field craft has been improved, the shooting skills and the tactics to be deployed against terrorists. And in terms of the infrastructure, most of them are going to be modern infrastructure towards enhancement of our security perimeter, smart fences, CCTVs, central control of all the activities. The government has given us authority to build or to create 27 Garud flights. Of each flight is about 45 strength, and 23 more are likely to be approved by the government, which will give us almost 50 flights of Garuds, almost 45 people per flight, to strengthen the security measures in all our high-value asset bases. So these are the areas where I think we have done well, and the effort continues to just transform the Air Force to make it more capable and provide the deterrence so that we never have a conflict. So before I take any more time. I'll request you all to ask questions if we have. I think this brief would have answered many of your questions. So I would request that you ask only one question per person. We still have about 20 odd minutes, and I'll be glad to answer them. Please don't ask more than one question. Thank you.
May I take on the question, sir? Pranay.
So you listed out achievements and setbacks, but you, sir, here.
Thank you.
So you listed out achievements and setbacks, but during your tenure, many defense corruption and especially the Air Force deals came under corruption charges, including Augusta Westland, Embraer. How satisfied you are with the efforts to weed out the problem of corruption when you would be leaving the office, and how these things will be tackled as far as the defense procurement and corruptions are concerned?
As far as defense procurement and corruption is concerned, such issues have come up from time to time. You know, I think every decade had some issues, be it Bofors or be it some other acquisition. There have been problems, and despite investigations, not much could be achieved by the investigating agencies to pin down people who are involved in corrupt practices. Yeah, definitely, if these corruption charges are proved, it is bad for the armed forces or whoever is involved. It is not only the armed forces who are involved in the procurement. There are so many agencies who are involved. So therefore, you cannot pin the blame to one particular organization or service. To my mind, many of the issues that has cropped up in the recent times has its origin quite some time back, at least a decade back, most of them. So these are being investigated. Therefore, to my mind, it will be premature for me to say anything, especially the AW101 case, where investigating agencies have found evidence, I believe. I do not know the exact evidence, and as a result of which, one of our former air chief was put into custody. That obviously has repercussions. What we are trying to do is that we believe that the Air Force believes, the people of the nation believe, that law of the land should be followed. We should accept that. And once the investigations are complete and once the judicial process is complete, whatever is the decision of the courts, we'll abide by that. But till the time a person is convicted, I think we should, you know, give him his due, whatever position he has had in the past. And especially an Air Force chief, former Air Force chief, is like a family member, extended family member. If anybody in my family goes through a rough patch, I think we should stand by that person. And if the charges are proved, then we have no sympathy for anyone. Whatever charges are proved, whatever convictions are there, we'll abide by that. So as of now, what we have done is, many of these procurement cases of the Air Force obviously has to come from the user, has to be originated by the user, so processed by the user. Then there are so many parties, so many stakeholders who come into it in determining the entire process and finally fructifying it as a contract and procuring the equipment. So if there are any wrongs being done anywhere, then the investigating agencies would definitely would get the information and the evidence and take action. As far as the Air Force is concerned, we have very clear-cut SOPs to be followed. We have very clear-cut procedures to be followed. We have very well-trained professionals who deal with acquisition or procurement, like test pilots, test engineers. It's not so for the other services, I can tell you that. And Air Force professionals are dealing with the subject very, very diligently, professionally, and wherever we have to exercise our specialist skills to give an opinion, we do it very diligently, and we have a lot of mechanisms to review each and every procurement that you do, many stages of this proper oversight. So to my mind, we are just reinforcing whatever is being done in the past. We are continuing it with the process. We are having better oversight. Thank you.
Ma'am.
Hi. Congratulations on a terrific tenure. Great knowing you. This is a quick question on the C-295s. What is happening regarding that? What exactly is the status? And the fact that the Navy has ordered a couple now, what about the maintenance? Will that be done by the IA by any chance?
I think this is a landmark, I would say landmark decision to manufacture these aircraft, transport aircraft, with 8 to 10 ton capacity in India, involving a private sector player, Indian. So that will enable and empower our private sector as well, help us in getting capabilities in the country with assistance of original equipment manufacturer, the C-295 project. If handled properly, I think it will pay very rich dividends to our aviation ecology, our capabilities. The progress has been made substantially towards evaluation. Evaluation is complete, and I think CNC is going to start very soon. And we expect, since benchmarking, a lot of other issues are already known to us, the process should not take very long, and especially so with a very proactive, I think, RM, Raksha Mantri. Things will get sorted out much faster, progress much faster than it used to take earlier. So to my mind, it should happen within about next 6 months' time. A contract should be signed because everybody's worked very hard. In terms of the Navy joining in and others joining in, that will happen after this contract has been signed, to my mind, because this is a contract for a certain number of aircraft. We can't increase the numbers midway. So to my mind, the decision for including the Coast Guard or the Navy to meet the requirements, any other agency to meet the requirements in terms of this platform would be processed subsequent to completion of the CNC. That is my understanding. But then if the situation demands that we should include them right up front, I'm sure the DSE and the government will take the appropriate call. As far as servicing, maintenance is concerned, that is one area that we have to discuss in the CNC. Thank you.
I'll request you to kindly tell your name and the agency before you, sir.
Morning, sir. Baran Rahal from SPs. What is your, how would you recall your best and the worst moments as the chief tenure? And also, sir, you did not speak about the air-to-air refueling capability. Around the mid of the year, the tender was cancelled. How do you perceive the tenders being cancelled just like that? Thank you.
Okay, so you have two questions. Right. I think I already mentioned in my tenure as a chief, the worst moment was when I came to know about the missing AN-32, because it had 29 lives. And unfortunately, we couldn't trace that aircraft. So it still weighs very heavily on my heart. After all,
the state is going on. What are the latest
about the AN-32? Yes, the AN-32, now we have searched all repeatedly. I think we have flown more than 300 sorties, close to more than 1,000 hours in that area of our interest. We could not locate anything. We used surface ships to do a lot of search with the equipment that they have, sonars, etc. Surface as well as subsurface search, seabed search has been carried out, but we could find only about 30 odd targets. I call it target because they look like similar in shape and size as the AN-32. At the bottom of the sea, which is 3.5 kilometers depth. So we have some agencies with us who have remotely operated vehicle, ROV, with such facilities to scan and image the surface. So after a lot of, effort, in searching for those and investigating them and reinvestigating those objects, those targets, they brought down to about 10 of them which could have been. Some of them were discounted after the ROV reached there and saw for itself and imaged, and there's nothing. Others could not be completed because the ROV itself went unserviceable and it had a lot of problems. See, operating at that depth is very difficult. The visibility at 3.5 kilometers depth in the sea with some equipment that we have, imaging equipment, is extremely difficult. So I think they have taken it for repairs. We're just waiting for the equipment to be returned and they can come back to search the remaining targets that is already been identified. And we have already approached the government to maybe contract some agencies from abroad who have the capability to do such search on the seabed. So that is the process is on. As of now, we do a few sorties now and then to see the surface of the sea, if there is anything. A lot of shipping is there in this belt, in this area. They all are being sensitized about this accident and to locate anything that they could see. We had identified large, or not detected large number of such objects on the sea, which could be part of this aircraft, but all of them proved to be other than this AN-32. The AN-32, unfortunately, most of these Soviet or the Russian aircraft do not have underwater locator beacons, ULBs. So we have taken up a case with the government, and it is the final stages. We'll procure a large number of ULBs as well as ELTs, you know, emergency locator beacon, PLBs, pilot locator beacon, and various other equipment that could indicate where this wreckage or this aircraft or the person is in a large area like the sea. So that is in process, and I think within another 1 or 2 months' time, the contract will be signed, and we'll have all our aircraft armed with ULBs and other locator beacons as well. So that is one thing we will not be able to. That was the worst moment. And in terms of good moments, I think we had plenty. So I can't really identify one particular event which has been very satisfying. Many, many events have been very satisfying for me. In terms of the next question, I forgot, and if you could remind me. Air-to-air refueling, okay. Air-to-air refueling, a very important force enhancer, force enabler. And we have, you know, that IL-78s. Which has served us well, though its availability is not too good because of the maintenance problems, etc. And we require much more for our commitment, be it the eastern sector, be it the western sector, or over the seas, Andaman Nicobar Command, etc. Our requirement is much more. So we thought that this case that we are progressing for acquisition of more flight refueling aircraft will go through quickly, because it's a strategic requirement, it's operational capability requirement. But unfortunately, there have been some anomalies, some problem areas in this acquisition process. So based on their appreciation, this has been cancelled as of now, and fresh ones, RFPs, will be floated very soon. Very, very unfortunate, but it happens. Our procurement process is slightly time-consuming, though it has been accelerated in the recent times. We are looking forward to the new RFP being floated and the contract being signed in the quickest possible manner. Thank you.
Jugal Puri.
Sir, Jugal Puri, you are from India today.
Yes, Jugal.
Just one corollary to what you asked. Would you say that perhaps not fitting the AN-32s with underwater locating beacons, like the Air Force and the Coast Guard already have, was that, would you say, a mistake or a lack of perhaps, you know, foresight? And also, sir, my question is, as the chairman of the Chief of Staff Committee, could you give us an appreciation about China in terms of its operations, the Air Force build-up, and its naval build-up?
Okay. Once again, two questions. I'll take only the last question. No, we are making an effort to get hold of ULBs, underwater locator beacon. Basically, the ULB is put in the flight data recorder, or the black box, so you can trace it. And ULBs are very effective in underwater because it operates on a radio frequency which is called very low frequency. So its penetration power through the medium of water is very good. So you can still look at it even if it is 3.5 kilometers in water. Okay, you can call it a mistake or otherwise, but it is not available in Russian fleet. So we have taken it up for getting it as quickly as possible. Western fleets are all capable and they have it. Since we also have other locator beacons in the aircraft, ULB is not so crucial to my mind. But definitely, AN-32 is not the best aircraft to fly this route for transportation of troops. And so we are making amend. We are just looking for the C-295. Earlier it comes, better it will be for us. We are trying to take our people across the Bay of Bengal from mainland to Andaman Nicobar Command by civil aircraft. That is safer because it can fly at higher altitude, whereas where the weather is not so intense. But the altitudes at which the AN-32 flies is not so good band in terms of weather. So it does get affected by the weather, and that could have been one of the reasons for this missing AN-32. The other thing you wanted was China. Well, I'd not take any country's name. We all are aware, every country has this right to make its own appreciation about its security needs. Every country has its rights to build up capability to tackle all the security concerns that it has, like we are doing. So it will not be appropriate for me to speak about any country in the neighborhood. But definitely, we take everything into consideration when you do the threat appreciation. Based on the threat appreciation, as well as our perception about ourselves, where you want to be now and in the future, what role you want to play in the region and the world stage, what reputation and you want to display to the world, we make our capability matrix. So it is not specific to any country. Yes, definitely some of the countries are doing very well. One of our neighbor has a lot of monies, you know, a lot of wealth. They have progressed very well, and they have enough funds to put into research and development, which is common knowledge. Everybody knows about it. So I did not reiterate that. But we have our own concerns. We are obviously building our capability not to actually fight a conflict. We are not keen to fight. We are not swelling for any such event. We believe in peace and tranquility, but we also know that we have been drawn into conflicts several times in the past. So going by the historical experience, we have to build our capability. Capability to deter. How will you deter an adversary who is strong? You have to build capability to be able to strike deep into the adversary's heartland. Take on targets effectively which will hurt the adversary. And that capability is being built up, especially with the Indian Air Force, the striking capability. We are building up our forces in the sea. The army is being strengthened further in terms of a new strike corps. So I think there is a lot of effort that is going on to tackle any contingency. Creation of infrastructure, induction of new equipment, and there is overall thrust by the government and the armed forces in bolstering our deterrence capability more than anything else. And it is not specific to any country or any adversary, to my mind.
Ajay Banerjee.
Good morning, sir. Ajay Banerjee from the Tribune. Sir, a year and a half ago, you had mentioned about the fighter aircraft fleet, that you were worried about the aging fleet of the fighter aircraft. My only one question is, could you give a lowdown on the actuality of all the progress you have made in your tenure on the FGFA, LCA you have just mentioned, Rafale you have mentioned, and the upgrades of the entire fleet? Could you please give a lowdown with timelines, please?
Okay. Now, everybody is aware that the teeth of the Air Force is in its combat fleet, fighter aircraft. And we have been sanctioned by the government for 42 such squadrons. This squadron strength is the numerical strength, but it has to be a capability mix from heavyweight spectrum to lightweight spectrum. In between, you'll have the medium weight spectrum. So what is happening is that we have large number of Sukhoi 30 aircraft, extremely capable aircraft, and it is due for a midlife upgrade. We'll be doing the midlife upgrade to enhance its operational capability in terms of radar, electronics, avionics, and weapons, more importantly. So that is in process. Obviously, the Sukhoi 30 fleet will last us, and we are still inducting. We have just inducted 10 squadrons, 3 more squadrons will be inducted. So it will last for another 30 to 40 years, spread over a period of time. Similarly, as I mentioned, LCA will fill up some void. At the other end, that is a lightweight category, it is also a fourth generation aircraft with fly-by-wire, good avionics, reasonably good radar. We are trying to upgrade it with an ISR radar, better electronics, warfare capability, better missiles combination with the new radar. All that is possible, air-to-air refueling. So this aircraft will be a good aircraft, fourth generation, maybe fourth plus, in the due course of time as we progress with the induction and improvements and upgrades that the country has planned with the ADA, HAL, and the Air Force. In terms of Rafale, it's an excellent aircraft. It is tremendously capable in all its role. It's a multi-role aircraft. It can be used very, very effectively. It will prove its worth in any situation, in any campaign. But we have just 36 aircraft. We have just signed for 36 aircraft. We require more aircraft in this middleweight category, 4-plus generation, to give us the entire spectrum capability in terms of fighter aircraft capability. So, inventory management is one. We definitely would like to have more of this type of aircraft. If we can get more of these under the Make in India concept or the initiative with a lot of transfer of technology and depth and, you know, and the type of technology transfer and creating, of course, cost will be an important factor, and creating jobs in the country, improving the ecology in terms of aviation, entire country, it will be good. It will be a good bargain, provided all these factors are favorable to us. But we definitely require something more than that, because the number of aircraft that we need to get in the next 5 to 10 years' time, because of the void that has been created in the past because of obsolescence, and also many more squadrons will become obsolete soon. We already used them for 4 decades plus. It's time to retire them and get new aircraft. So this void has to be filled up quickly. So 36 Rafales will not do. We will require much more.
Can you number? What number?
Number to my mind, over the next 10 years, we must have at least about 200 to 250 aircraft. No, category you can decide. It has to be fourth generation. But in the medium weight, you know, we have worked out certain figures. I'll not give you the figures right now. You'll quote me out of context. But it has to be balanced out. So the heavyweight spectrum, we already have enough, to my mind. And in the medium weight category, we need to have more. Yes, about 200 will be very good. Because we are already bidding for 126. We have just got 36. So obviously, the gap still exists. So I'm sure the government will take into consideration this aspect. And I think to fill up the gaps that is there, and the squadrons that will retire in the future, we'll have to have one more line of production in India under the Make in India policy initiative. And we have apprised the government about it. A lot of discussions are taking place. I'm sure in the very near future, some decisions will be taken how to go about it. As far as the FGFA is concerned, I think a lot of progress has been made in terms of negotiations, in terms of the R&D part of this project. The preliminary project definition phase is over, and things have worked out quite well. But R&D phase, we had some doubts which have been clarified. Now it is with the Ministry of Defense and the government to take a call how to go about it. Because we require a lot of visibility in terms of transfer of technology, work share, the actual technology that is being developed, whether it meets the our SQRs, and of course, the visibility in terms of cost. So these things are still being negotiated, and I'm sure something will come out of it sooner than later. I'm not going to all the nitty-gritty. Once I tell you something, it will be quoted in future. So I'll leave it at that.
May I have the permission to take one last question, sir?
Two more questions, yes.
Rajat Pandit.
Yeah, Rajat Pandit from Times of India. China has strongly objected to the Agni 5 test yesterday. As Chairman, Chiefs of Staff Committee, what do you have to say about that?
This is, I think, in international diplomacy, be it normal diplomacy or military diplomacy, these posturings and signalings will always be there. So we should just go about our own task, meet our own requirements, the security challenges. We would not like to comment on what somebody else is doing unless it is prohibited, like nuclear proliferation, which is common knowledge to everyone, what is happening in this region in terms of collusiveness, transfer of technologies, which is forbidden. So this is all common knowledge. I'm not saying something new. And obviously, then we have reason to speak about it. But if we are legitimately developing our capability indigenously, I don't think anybody should complain about it.
Sujan Datta.
I'm with the Telegram. Sir, could you describe to us the Indian Air Force effort to transport cash in the wake of demonetization, beginning with whether you have had to wait at an ATM queue or wait in a queue to deposit cash in a bank?
You see, I think this is a very huge initiative that has been taken by the central government, demonetization. And we did realize, and the government, to my mind, also realizes that, you know, there has been a lot of hardship for the people because of non-availability of cash in the ATMs and in the banks, etc. So we are there to serve the nation, serve the government, like HADR, aid to civil authorities, be it law and order situation, be it the suffering our people have to undergo and sort of relief, provide relief to that. So the Air Force has pitched in to carry cash from our mints. I think there are four places where the mints are there. And we have put into service our C-130s, the C-17, the heavy lift aircraft. So large volumes of cash have been carried from one place to another to overcome this problem of shortage of cash. And as of today, I think we have flown close to 35 sorties, and we have carried nearly 610 tons of cash to various places. We are happy that we could serve the people and the nation in because of this contingency that has developed in the recent past. We've also helped the government in running at least one of the mints 24/7 with the help of our people. That, I think, is perfectly all right in terms of serving the nation and its people to overcome the difficulties that they're facing currently. Thank you very much. It's been a great pleasure interacting with you. I think that, you know, the cooperation and the understanding that you have had in the past 3 years have been outstanding. I'd like to thank each one of you for that. And I'm sure in the future, after I retire, we'll meet and maybe talk more freely. And I'm sure you'll continue this relationship with the Air Force and the next leadership under Air Marshal. Then, of course, it will be Chief Marshal Dhanwa. in the future. Thank you.